Hello friends. So in the previous sessions, couple of sessions, we have seen what is the effect of changes of load on the synchronous motor. And we saw that in the lead section and the lag section, we considered it separately. So in the lead section, when the synchronous motor in the lead section, as you increase the load, what happens? The delta increases, the IA value increases, the cos theta actually improves, the cos theta increases. By the time you come to the lagging side, as you continue increasing the load, the IA will increase, the delta will increase. However, the power factor becomes more and more poor because theta value increases in that case. So today we are going to see the second change here. What is the next parameter that we can change? That what is in our control is that it's the field current. Okay. So today we are going to see what is the effect of changes in the field current on the synchronous motor. Okay. So let's take the first quantity, which is EA usually. EA is equal to K phi omega, right? And flux is proportional to the field current, right? So when you are changing the value of IF, naturally EA is going to change. Okay. So in this vector diagram that we are going to see, EA value is going to change. Okay. So first is that EA is proportional to the field current. Okay. So that is one thing. The another thing that we have to see is a constraint which we have to put on this phasor diagram. Okay. This is a constraint that we are going to put on the phasor diagram is that the real power supplied, okay, the real power supplied by the synchronous motor, you have already seen that it is always proportional to the load on the motor, right? So if the load on the synchronous motor is more, the real power supplied by the synchronous motor will be more. So the output power is more, and naturally when the output power is more, the input power drawn also must be high. Okay. So that means if the load is constant, so in this entire explanation, we are going to keep the load value to be constant. Therefore, the real power supplied will be equal to a constant value. That means power, which is equal to 3 into EA V phase sine delta divided by XS. This is the input power. So because the output power is constant, naturally all other input parameters also will be equal to a constant value. Now V phase is constant, XS is constant. That means for power to be equal to constant, the power to be equal to constant, what should be constant? EA sine delta should be constant. V phi is constant, XS is constant, 3 is a constant. That means for power to be equal to a constant value, okay, first condition, constrain it, EA sine delta should be a constant value. The power is also equal to root 3 into VL into, we'll just put 3 into V phase into IA into cos theta. Okay, this is another equation. V phase is constant, 3 is constant. That means for power to be constant, IA cos theta also has to be equal to a constant value. So this is the next set of constraints. Okay, so EA is going to change, whereas EA sine delta and EA cos theta has to be constant. EA can change, keeping EA sine delta and EA cos theta to be equal to a constant value. Now here I have drawn the phasor diagram in a lagging condition, and you will see as the explanation proceeds, this is called the under excited condition of the synchronous motor. Okay, so at some field current, you are getting this value here. Okay. So the current is lagging, everything is well and good. So now we are going to increase the value of IF. Okay, so IF is going to increase. So as IF increases, what will happen to EA? IF increases, flux increases. Flux increases, EA value increases, right? EA value increases. But EA has to increase keeping EA sine delta constant. Okay, so what is EA sine delta value? EA sine delta is this vertical distance, right? So horizontal distance is EA cos delta and the vertical distance is EA sine delta. That means this line, if I put here, if I put a line here like this, okay, so if I just so any point here like this, this EA sine delta will be constant. Therefore, EA can be moving only on this locus. EA can increase its value, but it will only move through this locus. But because only in this locus, this vertical distance is exactly the same value. Okay, so this is the locus of EA sine delta equal to a constant value. Okay, you will see that EA value will increase because IF is increasing. Now, IA cos theta also has to be a constant. So, IA cos theta is this horizontal distance, right? IA cos theta is this horizontal distance like this. Okay, so this distance, horizontal distance has to be constant. Therefore, IA can move only along this particular axis. Okay, so this is the IA cos theta equal to constant. So I hope it's clear. To keep the vertical distance, EA can move only in this axis. To keep the horizontal distance, IA can move only in this particular axis. Okay, we'll see that. Okay, so for example, if you have increased the value of EA and say it comes around at this particular value here. So I'll just draw the new value. I'll try to make it as neat as possible. Yeah. So this value is EA2. Okay. And EA2 is greater than EA1. Okay. EA2 is greater than EA1. So I can just draw the J into IA into XS value here. So this is J into IA into XS. I'm not putting that because it gets cluttered. So based on this, I can find the current vector. So this will be the direction of the current vector, right? Now current will be 90 degree lagging to J into IA into XS. So if I put that here somewhere, so I'll just use a different color for the current here. So somewhere around here, it will be the current axis. Okay. So you see the current can move only along this green line. Let me just put that in the green line. Okay. The current can only move along this green line here. Okay. So this is the next value of current, IA2. So let me just mark IA2 here with say a violet color here. So this is IA2. From here to here is the value of IA2. You can clearly see, even though the cos theta theta value has reduced, initially from here to here you are having the theta value. Now from it is from here to here. Okay, theta value has reduced, but however IA cos theta value is exactly the same. If you find IA1 cos theta will be equal to IA2 cos theta. That is the importance of moving along this particular line. Okay, so what you have found here is that now the synchronous motor, we started in the lag condition. So as IF increased, EA value increased, and you see that the magnitude of IA has actually reduced, right? The magnitude of IA has actually reduced, but however IA cos theta is constant. Okay, so IA value has actually reduced. Now we may come at this particular point. As you are continuously increasing the IF value, you will come at this particular point, and I'm not drawing that vector here for EA, but however J into IA into XS will be like this, a vertical line. Okay, that means IA value will be a horizontal line. This will be the IA vector, right? So at that particular point, IA3 will be something like this. Okay, right? This will be the value of IA3. And you can see that it is in the UPF condition. So in this particular condition and this excitation at which the current and voltage are in phase with each other is called a normal excitation. Okay, so at this condition, it is a lagging condition here. At this point, it becomes in the UPF condition. For example, you continue increasing the value of IA. Okay, IF, sorry. If you continue increasing the value of IF, so for example, you come where somewhere around here. Okay, so I will just try to draw the value of EA. So this is our EA3. Okay, so this is our EA3 value. So I can put the J into IA into XS. It will look like this, right? J into I into XS is from EA to V phase. Okay. So IA value will be 90 degree lagging to that. So this will be the IA value. And so approximately this is the IA vector, right? So this is the value of IA4. Now as I continue moving in, for example, I come to here, this IA3, right? So yeah, this IA3. If I continue moving, okay, in the lead area, now we have reached the lead area, right? So we have reached the lead area. So let's take one more point here. So in the lead area, if I continue moving, I will not draw the EA vector, but it's very much basic common sense that the current vector will look like this, right? The current vector will look like this. So in the leading area, what happens is that as IF increases, okay, EA naturally increases, EA always increases, right? But the IA value also increases in the leading area. See, IA value also increases in the leading area, okay? Now in the lag area, you can see that the theta value is reducing, so power factor will increase, okay? But whereas in the leading area, if this was theta, say theta 3, this angle will be theta 4, right? So theta has increased, that means cos theta will reduce, okay? So these are different things which you can see here. So let us consolidate everything into one thing here. So starting from the lagging condition, okay, starting from the lagging condition, you are increasing the field current. Okay, you are increasing the field current. So when you increase the field current, EA increases, right? EA increases and IA value decreases, okay, as you are increasing the field current in the lagging area, and the cos theta increases. That is clearly seen from this phasor diagram here. At one point, you will reach UPF condition, okay, and then you are in the leading area. Okay, now you are in the starting the leading area. Okay, so as you continue to increase the value of IF, in lagging area, the current value was decreasing, right? But in the leading area, the current value will actually start to increase. So IA will increase. However, because theta is increasing, cos theta will reduce. Okay. So I hope things are clear till now. Now, in this region, you can clearly see that because the synchronous motor is acting as a lagging load, so the synchronous motor is a lag load here, as far as the power system is concerned. Here, the synchronous motor is acting as a leading load. Okay, so this is a leading load. Okay, or it behaves as like a capacitor. Like it is having a, it is behaving like a capacitive load here. Okay, so based on all these conclusions, we can draw a graph between the armature current versus the field current. Okay, based on all these conclusions, we can draw a graph between armature current and the field current. Okay, so let's draw that now very quickly. So this is IA and this is the field current. Okay, so initially you started with a low value of field current and you are gradually increasing, then you come to the lagging condition, then you come to the UPF condition, then you are going to the leading condition. So similarly, I can mark some points here. So here I will use the, this is the lagging area, and this point let it be the UPF area, and here it is the leading area. Okay, so in the lagging area, you see that as IF increases, IA decreases. Okay, for example, so you are starting with some current value here, for some field value here, you are having some current value here. So as you increase the value of field current, from here to here, you are increasing the field current. So in the lagging area, the IA actually reduces. Okay, and it comes the minimum in the UPF section. Okay. Once you reach the leading side, which is this thing here, as you increase the value of field current, so you are moving continuously in this direction, IA actually increases, right? So it looks something like this. Okay. Now this is representing, say P1, proportional to P1. For example, you are having P2, which is greater than P1. The graph would start at a little bit at higher point, and it would be something like this. And it would be something like, so this is representing P2, where P2 is greater than P1. If you are having P3, it will be something like this, and it will go. And this is P3, where P3 is greater than P1, P2 is greater than P1. These kinds of graph between the armature current and the field current of a synchronous motor, when you are like changing the field excitation, is called a V curve. Okay. It is called a V curve of a synchronous motor. It is clearly seen why it is called a V curve, because the curve has a V shape here. Okay. So this area is lag and this area is lead. So I hope that thing is clear. Now let us come to the different excitation states, which we have seen in the explanation here. Okay. So first explanation was that this was your V phase, right? And here was your EA. Okay. So this was in the lag condition, right? This was in the lagging condition. The field current is so low that the synchronous motor comes into a lagging condition. And in the leading condition, so this was V phase, okay, and the EA was looking something like this, right? And this angle was delta, and this is the leading condition. Now, how to define whether a synchronous motor is in a lagging condition or a leading condition? You cannot tell it with an absolute value. You have to use something else, okay? So if you take the projection here, if we take the projection here, this horizontal distance EA cos delta, right? This horizontal distance EA cos delta is less than V phase, right? So EA cos delta is less than V phase. So when this condition exists for a phase field current value where EA cos delta is less than V phase, is called the under excited condition of the synchronous generator. Okay. It is called the under excited condition of the synchronous generator, sorry, synchronous motor. So if I have told generator multiple times, please correct it as motor. Okay. So now let us take this leading condition where the synchronous EA was in this particular position. Let's take the horizontal value here. Okay. Horizontal value from here to here. Okay. So that value is again EA cos delta. But here in the leading condition, you can see EA cos delta is greater than the value of V phase. Okay. EA cos delta is greater than the value of V phase. This is called the over excitation of the synchronous generator. Okay. Over excited condition of the synchronous generator. Now there is an in-between condition in between all these things where the thing exists like this. Okay. In this case, you can see that the EA cos delta is equal to the value of V phase, and this is called the normal excitation of the synchronous generator. Okay, so in under excited condition, you can clearly see the synchronous generator is like a lagging load, like synchronous motor is like a lagging load, and here in normal excitation it was like a unity power factor load, and in the over excitation it was like a leading load. Okay, now when a load is a lagging load, what happens? It consumes reactive power, right? It consumes reactive power. Okay, and when a system is leading characteristics, it generates reactive power, right? It generates reactive power. So an overexcited synchronous motor actually generates reactive power, so it has the same properties like a capacitor. Okay, this is a topic which we will discuss in a lot of depth in the future sessions, so just remember what I have told now. So it generates reactive power, or you can tell it consumes negative reactive power. Here for example, you are taking plus Q to be the positive consumption, absorption is plus Q, that means in this case it will be minus Q. Okay, so in the normal excitation, what happens? It only generates active power. Okay, it does not consume or produce any reactive power. It generates active power in the sense whatever it produces, it's just active power, it's just mechanical power, raw mechanical power. Okay, so it is like a resistive load. Okay, so this is just like behaving like a resistive load, it just consumes active power. Okay, so I'll just put that as it only consumes active power. Okay, it only consumes active, that's the correct term to put here. So today we have started with field excitation, and we saw that as field current increases from lagging to leading condition, so in the lag condition, as field current increases, IA value reduces, cos theta increases, right? And as you continue, you will finally reach the UPF condition, and beyond that you go to the leading condition. And in the leading condition, is if IF increases, IA increases and cos theta drops. Okay, now I will put a question for you here. What about delta? Okay, you can clearly see as IF is increasing, the delta value is reducing. So for example, initially EA1, this is the delta angle, right? For EA1, this is the delta angle. And for EA2, this is the delta angle. And for EA3, this is the delta angle. So you can clearly see the delta angle is reducing. Why don't you tell me why this happens? Okay, so that I am putting as open question for you. Please think about this. If you have liked this video, please like, share and subscribe the channel. Please recommend these videos with your friends and anyone who is interested in electrical engineering. And because this channel has other courses like engineering circuit analysis, synchronous generators and synchronous motor is already running. So till I see you in the next video, it's me Varun signing off. Have a great day. Thank you.